Aren't you glad for that? Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. It's good to be in service. We'd like to welcome each and every one here tonight. And as you can see, Brother Louie's not here. But we're going to have Brother Jimmy Babb come in a few moments and lead us. Or he's going to read our prayer requests. And then we'll go to the Lord in prayer for the needs of the people. I'd like for you to remember... when he comes tonight, also my wife, she's at home sick, Sister Shirley, and we're getting ready to leave on a trip to Arizona, so we really need your prayers. It's no fun to travel when you're not feeling good. So let's sing it one more time, Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow. Brother Jimmy Babbs, would you come and read our prayer request, and then we'll go to the Lord in prayer. Because He Lives, I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All my fear is gone, because I know He holds my future and life. It's worth the living just because He lives.
Okay, we have several announcements, and I'll just do those first before we go into the prayer request. And let me go through these here real quickly that I didn't have. Okay. First of all, I think we have some visitors with us tonight. We want to welcome them. I think Brother Robert Marrero is here with some of his people. We're certainly glad that they're with us tonight. When we finish, Brother Robert, I'd like for you to come up and lead us in prayer. Where are you seated, Brother Robert and the people that's with him? Okay, God bless. Brother Robert is here, isn't he? Okay, didn't see him. Also, Daniel Buckner and Hannah Buckner visiting with us tonight. Would you raise your hand? God bless you. Let's give them a nice hand, Brother Robert and his people. Listen very carefully that this one, both buses for the spring camp are already filled. We have no seats left. And if any of you have already decided that you're not going to be able to go, We need to know that as quickly as possible. We've already started a waiting list for people who have called and want their name put on a waiting list. So if you've not decided, that's fine. But if you do know that you're not going, please don't delay in letting us know so that we can let people on a waiting list try to work them in. And also we have a Sister Laura Wyko just gives a testimony. I want to thank everyone for their prayers for me during my recent sickness. It's so good to be able to be back in church. She just wants to praise the Lord and thank God for each of your prayers. There's also a CD that's available in the library that Brother Donnie, Brother Harry, and Brother Chuck were on it from 1983, I believe this says. This all started by a brother who called and requested a song that they sang, I guess, in that year. And was finally located, and Brother Michael put together a little CD that goes all the way back to this. So if you're interested, you can purchase it in the library. Also, we want to pray for Sister Sarah Carroll. She has a stomach virus and couldn't be in the service tonight. Also, Scotty Babb and Ashley and Courtney are not feeling well, so let's remember them. Pray for a very urgent, unspoken request for the Wes Willis family. They've asked us to remember them in prayer tonight. Continue to pray for Sister Christine Baker, who is still having neck problems. She is in service tonight over in the fellowship hall, but continue to remember her in prayer. Sharon Buckner has pancreas trouble. Please pray that she may see God in healing for her body. Also pray for Catherine Buckner. So let's remember those two in prayer. Remember a teenager by the name of Dakota Frith. He needs salvation and a direction in his life. Leah Rudder, my aunt, fell and broke her hip and needing hearing also. Her granddaughter needs healing. Her father, my cousin Amos Rudder, has been streaming our services turned in by Brother Amos. Let's remember that. This is from Sister Natalie Yance. My mother and I will be leaving for the Cancer Treatment Center tomorrow for 6 weeks for radiation treatments. I had a wreck on Thursday evening, which totaled my van. I am very sore, but did not have one scratch, scrape, or bruise. And she does want to praise God for that. So we're grateful for that. But remember Sister Natalie and Sister Linda, her mother, as they travel. And each day, we should have it on our heart that this God would move for them. Brother Larry and Sister Lisa Miller wants to thank everyone for their prayers, cards, and calls during the passing of Larry's mother. So they just want to extend their thanks to the church. Sister Carol asked us to pray for her sister Sharon. She is not feeling well after surgery on Wednesday. So let's remember Sharon also in prayer. Brother Robert, if you would come at this time, if everyone would stand. All the unspoken prayer requests, just the raising of your hand. And remember to pray for your neighbor that's standing next to you. And one more here that's come in, Brother Keith Phillips. He asked for prayer as he's sick in body tonight.
How many happy to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Amen. How many believe that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever? It's good to see you folks. It's good to be back here in Johnson City and see such precious people. I'm identified with you all. Amen. Let's pray for this request. Most gracious Heavenly Father, We give you thanks, Father, that you're still God and your mercy is great. Father, you have never failed your bride. And we believe that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. Father, hearing of so many needs, Father, you said that your bride will always be a needed people. Father, we always depend upon you, Father. God, we love you tonight, and we pray in this hour that the Holy Spirit may come and visit every person that is sick, every request that was put up in this pulpit, Father. May the Holy Spirit, let it be sickness, whatever need it may be, Father. You're still God, and we believe that you're still God. You never change, Father. I pray that your Spirit, God, may visit these people and heal them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray, God. Amen. Amen.
Amen. You to remain standing with us this evening. The brothers that come, I'd like for them to receive the offering. I'd like to sing together an old song this evening. I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. Amen? And you just got to be standing to sing this song. And if you don't know it, then it'll be a new old song to you. And let's see if we can get the words up here. The first verse. Amen. In this world I've tried most everything, and I'm happy now to say that there's nothing religion in the good old-fashioned way. I'm walking in the old-time way, and I want the world to know that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. Nothing like an old-time Christian with a Christian love to show. I'm walking in the grand old highway, and I'm telling everywhere I go that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. There are many things I'd like to be as my journey I pursue. I've longed to be a leader like a mortal. With a million to bestow, but I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. Oh, I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. There's nothing like an old-time Christian with a Christian love to show. Oh, I'm walking in the grand old highway, and do you know that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. All the world is bright since I got by. Now I'm king and pray and shout. All my burdens have been lifted since the Savior brought me out. I will tell the world both far and near as I travel here below that I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know. Like an old-time Christian with a Christian love to show. Oh, I'm walking in the grand old highway, but I'd rather be an old-time Christian than anything I know.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated.
Sister Gerald Yance has a song for us. If she'd come at this time, maybe we'll sing a little chorus while she's coming. God is so good. Amen. Can you say amen to that? God is so good. Oh, God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. I love him so, and I love him so. I love him so. I love him so. He's so good to me.
Today I'm in a sinker's world, fighting this battle below. Today my heart is heavy, the tears don't cease to flow. Today I may be wounded by a friend that I love dear, but tomorrow
praise the Lord. I actually tried to practice a song this evening in case Brother Louis was here and he asked me to sing. But there's there's a downside to that. I left the words at the house. if you know this song, you help me sing the chorus. Maybe I'll remember the verse. I was singing this going down the road the other day. You know, The Lord God is a mighty God, but if you don't recognize that He's a mighty God to you personally, it's not going to help you a whole lot. And I believe when He died for me. I've got to believe that to get all the benefits of Calvary, I've got to believe it was for me, not just for somebody else. And hopefully I can remember the words. See, brother, I think. I never saw the cross He carried up to Calvary's hill. I never saw the precious blood that my Savior spilled. And I never heard the mob that cried, "Oh, let Him be crucified." No, I never saw it, but I believe for me He died, and every step He took to Calvary, and every drop of blood He would have shed it just for me. There's a many burdens that my Savior bore. I never saw the crown of thorns that my Jesus wore. I never saw the mob that cried, "Oh, no, I never saw it, but I believe for me He died, and every step He took to Calvary. Just for me, there's a lot of things I may not see, but I believe when Jesus died, He died for me. There's a lot of things I may not see, but I believe when Jesus died, He died for me.
Aren't you glad it can be that personal tonight? To know if you was the only one, that there was only one name on that Lamb's Book of Life, He would have paid it all. Let's turn, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20. What a privilege it is for us to be gathered together in the house of God tonight. So I'm glad to have Brother Robert Marrero and some of the saints from up New York way, up in New Jersey. Appreciate them coming by to be in fellowship with us tonight and in the morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20. I'd like to speak to you tonight on the anointed word. The anointed word. How many believes the word's wonderful? How many know the word needs the anointing on it to make it alive? But what does that mean exactly? That the word needs to be anointed. Anointing is not emotion. And we feel it. We feel the anointing. But this type of anointed that we're talking about is not actually even a feeling. It's not a sensation. It's not an emotion. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20. For the kingdom of God is not in word, which is logos, saying of speech, what someone has said, a word, the sayings of God, decree, mandate, or order, of the moral precepts, given by God, doctrine, teaching. So the kingdom of God is not just teaching. The kingdom of God is not just word. Amen. And the church said,
amen.
For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. In power. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. Who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. How in the world can the word, the letter, kill? How can it do it? Well, all it takes is a good argument between two preachers, them slanging that word around, and you'll see how it kills. Now watch, the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 5. And Paul says, for our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
And in much assurance.
Yes,
and you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Now let's read Hebrews chapter 5. Brother Bam says, you see, the scriptures, no matter how well you know them, if the Spirit doesn't quicken them, the letter killeth, the Spirit giveth life. See, it must be quickened or made alive.
Amen.
By the Spirit. If the Spirit doesn't liven the word and make it a reality to you, the letter is just intellectual.
Yes.
Now, the greatest preacher in this message, whoever that would be, the devil can outquote him, outpreach him, and as far as theology, the devil can understand more theology than the greatest preacher in this message. Because he can understand the letter. But Satan don't have access to the quickening power of God. Now gifts, you know, all that sort of thing, that's separate from what I'm talking about. The anointed is not gifts. The anointed is not fast music. The anointed is the Messiah. The set apart. I'm not talking about false anointings, the end time. The Messiah. Notice this. If the Spirit doesn't liven the word and make it a reality to you, then the letter is just intellectual. And that's where we have so many confessed Christians today, or professed Christians, is the intellectual conception of Christ. Let's bow our heads together. Heavenly Father, we love you tonight. We're so grateful, Lord, that we could be together here again in your presence, and how we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you've called us, given us the chance that we could have our hearts open to your great illumination in this day. We're so thankful, Father, that you've not called us to a creed. You've not called us, dear God, just to a bunch of fanaticism, but you've called us to the volume of the book, to yourself. And we know when you came, you were not word only, but you were the anointed word. So I pray that you would help us that we would be able to see our position not just by quotes and not just by scriptures, but may the same Messiah anoint us to our position. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, saints. You may be seated. Brother Bill, glad to see you again tonight, buddy. Hope you're feeling well. Now, let me ask you a very bold, blunt, and shocking statement to open up with tonight. When did Jesus become the Messiah? When did Jesus become the Messiah? The proper answer to that question will tell you when you did. Now, this word, God allowed the prophets of the Old Testament to speak and forecast and prophesy and foretell of events that would come to pass hundreds and even thousands of years after they spoke it. No doubt many of them didn't even understand what they had to say. Sometimes they would get so under the inspiration of that prophecy, they would act as if though it was themselves. David, in reiterating the prophetic word of God, no doubt many times, as he was a very passionate type of individual about his love for God, and no doubt the people would hear some of the words that he had to say, and it was almost as if he was acting it out himself. Sometimes they would say, "Thus saith the Lord," and sometimes they wouldn't. Many of the prophecies, the messianic prophecies of the Old Testament, never had a "thus saith the Lord" attached to the end of it. Some of them did. Others of them would be like, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? All my bones, they stare at me. They pooch their lips out at me. Not one "thus saith the Lord" was attached to that. But yet it was "thus saith the Lord." So God would do it in a way that he would say, "Thus saith the Lord." Then he would do it in a way to where he would act it out, like in Joseph. The Joseph would take a Gentile bride, yet Joseph never said, "Thus saith the Lord, I'm doing this as a type." Because the mystery of Christ was written in his life. So the prophecy that he was telling about was actually by his actions of an everyday life. And he was anointed to set forth that prophetic utterance in his life. Now, God, through Moses, through Jeremiah, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, all the different ones, they would say, "Thus saith the Lord, God will do this," and "Thus saith the Lord, God will do that." And then there was other times God never said that at all. He would say it in such a way it would be right in the middle of a sentence. Or this scripture would be, verse 1 would be applying to Jesus, and verse 2 would be applying to present day conditions in Israel. Verse 3 might be 1,000 years down the road of the Babylonian captivity. But yet God so wrote it in such a way it would take the Spirit of God to ever pick it up, or you'd never understand it. Now notice, why would God do such a thing? Because the devil had been, remember, right there as we looked at it Wednesday night, before the throne of God. So he understands so much about God. He understands much about God's approach. He understands much about the word of God as far as the Logos. And he's able to pick up on things that God is going to do. And many times Satan will forerun those events on the earth before God ever even does them. You ever wonder why there were people named Jesus before Jesus was named Jesus, and the name Jesus hadn't even been uttered yet by the angel's voice? You ever wonder why in this age there were so many Elijahs that come forth before Brother Branham ever come on the earth? How did the devil know it's time for Elijah? How did the devil know it's time for one to arise by the name of Meshach Jesus? Yahshua, how did he know that? So he was able to look into the word and be able to peer into it and be able to see it was certain times for this and that and the other. But God separated the quickening power from the word. Now he can be able to take the word, study it, memorize it, look at it, but Satan will never have access to that quickening power of God. So then the word has to be anointed, the word has to be placed, and the believers of the day must be identified with the same
same anointing that will come upon that word which pulls their soul under the same anointed path of the Spirit of God. Now others will sit around the Logos and they'll hear the doctrines. They'll hear the Logos, the word, and boy, they feed on it. Man, they think it's wonderful. They'll argue, they'll debate, they'll fuss, but they'll never move under the anointed word to where it becomes a position to them. It's only they're around it by fellowship and they're identified by the way they dress and a certain way they look. And everybody else looks at them and think, man, they're a believer because they got long hair and they got this and that and the other. But that ain't necessarily just what God's looking at. God is looking for the anointed word. Now remember, don't think in your mind that I'm saying just jumping and shouting and running, because we believe in all that too. But we have no scripture in the Bible that ever told us Jesus ever had one shouting spell when he was here. Anybody show me in the book of Acts where they ever shouted the way we do? Yet I believe in that too. But yet we want to make it what we think it is. Is there any scripture in the Bible where Paul ever danced in the Spirit the way we do? What about Peter? What about James, John? What about, where is that in the Bible? It's not in the Bible. But yet it's something that we thought, oh, those are the most annoying. Those that shout and those that, oh man, a preacher talks so fast and the music is so fast. If you can't worship God on a slow song like a fast song, you are in tradition, Pentecostal tradition. I know, I've been there. But now, whenever it comes into the anointed word, then whether it is slow or fast, whether it is something that God is doing that is deep, or something that God that is saying that is simple, those who are anointed with the word, they become under that word, and it's more than just quotes to them. It's more than just scriptures to them in theology. It's actually the anointed word which is set aside, and they become part of that message itself. Now, many think they're part of this message because they listen to tapes, and they think they're part of the message because they quote Brother Branham. That's not what makes you a part of the message of the day. Only God can make you a part of the message, and that is God himself must set you apart and anoint you with the quickening power to quicken your life to the word. Right. Now watch, let me answer the question, because I said y'all ain't going to answer it for me. So when did Jesus become the Messiah? Oh, you say when he was born. Oh no. Oh, you say, well, when it come from the mind of God. Oh, no. It's contrary to the message. My Lord, am I at Happy Valley? Surely I ain't at Sinking Creek. Even the preachers are looking at me bug-eyed. Notice this. Brother Man says, when the Holy Spirit came upon him at the baptism of John, he became the anointed Messiah. Now it was the word at his birth. He was a virgin born son of God. That's not what makes you Messiah, being the word. Because the trees are the word. Every tree could trace its beginning back to the original. It come from a spoken word seed of God. So that makes that tree the word. The earth that we're sitting on tonight is the word. The heavens are the word. But can they save us? Can they die for us? Of course not. Can they heal us? Of course not. But they are not the anointed word of this hour. Are they the word? They are. Now notice, so Jesus then, born of a virgin, and when he comes to the earth and he comes and he takes on the image of a human being becoming flesh, because his brothers were going to be flesh. So it become him to be made like unto his brethren, Paul says. So when he was born, he was the word, but he was not the anointed word. Watch. Now he says, remember, he was the Son of God when he was born. He was God's virgin born son. But when he become Messiah, that's when the Holy Spirit come on him. Because the Messiah means the shouting ones, the jumping ones, the jerking ones. The Messiah means the anointed one. That's what I said, we believe in jerking and we believe in shouting and we believe in all those emotions. But that within itself is not the anointing. The anointing of this hour will quicken our life to the word. And if you say that you believe this word and yet whatever's on you quickens you away from the message of this hour, I question your anointing. It don't make a lick of sense to me that God would send a prophet to this earth and give us a message and tell us it don't make no difference. Everybody else is going to the rapture too. That's a bunch of hogwash. If you're going in the rapture, you're going by the means of this message, because this is a rapture message. The Baptists don't have one. The Methodists don't have one. The Pentecostals don't have a rapture message. It must come to Malachi 4 or we don't go. Now, you can be anointed with the Holy Spirit on the outside and still not be anointed. You can be anointed and scream and shout and jump and cast out devils and oh my, just whoop it up big time and have a great big time every time you go to church and still not be the anointed word. Whew. Well, glory, I come to have church. What'd y'all come to have? Now notice, when he become Messiah, that's when the Holy Spirit come on him. Because the Messiah means the anointed one. He was the anointed one when the Holy Spirit came on him. Now notice how that Jesus himself, this is my terminology now, Jesus himself, he's born, his name is to be called Jesus, not Jesus Christ. He will be called Jesus Christ after he is anointed. Now, when he comes to the earth, he severs himself from that quickening power because he is the head of the new race. So if he comes from the womb, the anointed word, then that means when you come to the earth, you'll have to come the anointed word too. So he come to the earth as the word expressed through the womb of a virgin, but he still is not the Messiah or the anointed word until he receives the Holy Ghost. Glory. Now we might quote the message, we might quote the Bible, and we might know it by heart and memory, but we are not the anointed word until we receive the quickening power that quickens our lives to match the identification of what God is saying in this hour. I ain't interested in what you think God's got on his mind. I ain't interested in what the church is saying. I want to know here from God himself, what's God got on his mind for this age? God want us to go back to repeated Pentecost. God want us to go back to 1906. That's fine. That's what I'll do if that's what God wants. But I want to make sure it's God and not you. Watch this again, Jehovah of Miracles. After he was anointed of God, filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh my goodness. Some of the Jesus onlys in the Message, poor old things, they just about choked to death on these quotes. It's amazing, you know, lots of folks choke to death every year on food. While other folks sit down and eat it and they get a fat belly, and others you choke them to death. Same food. You can get a steak off of a cow and choke you to death. You can get one and you can just walk up and say, man, that was the best steak I ever had in my mouth. I'm on the same cow. Some folks will hear a sermon, it chokes them to death. Like, others say, man, that was good. I'd like to have another one of them. Boy, that was good. Now watch this. When Jesus receives the Holy Ghost, I mean, say amen to that. After he was anointed of God, filled with the Holy Ghost, cause the Messiah was the anointed one. Is that right, brethren? Yes, sir. The anointed one. But now he's not the only one casting out devils. Because Jesus told them Pharisees, and he said, if I'm casting out devils by the finger of God, then who do your children cast them out by? But they wasn't the anointed one, but yet they had an anointing. Caiaphas was a devil in his heart, but he had an anointing, but he was not the anointed one. Many will come to me in that day and say, Lord, we cast out devils in your name. We heal the sick. We've done all this, that, and the other. Jesus didn't say, you never done it, you bunch of liars. But he said, depart from me, I never knew you. They were anointed, but they were not the anointed one that I'm talking about tonight, Messiah. Notice again, he said, now the first thing he did after his temptation in the wilderness, he came forth as the anointed Messiah. The Messiah, the Christ. The Christ means the anointed one. Now see, this is what makes folks so nervous when you go to make a statement like this. And let me just make it to you up front so you'll know who I believe I am. I believe I'm Christ. Christ. Anybody else here believe you are? If you're going to plan on going to the rapture, you better get that hand in there. Now, if you want to be a Branhamite, Branhamite's saying what's going in the rapture? Christ. Christ. The anointed word. But why does that stumble people? Because they don't understand what Messiah means. They think Messiah is one person. The Bible does not teach that. The Bible nor the message does not teach Messiah is one person. It's this part that comes from God, that supernatural life that comes and anoints that word and takes that word and changes it from a dead letter and transforms it into a living epistle known and read of all men. The anointed word. Notice he says he was born Jesus the man. But when the Holy Ghost came into him, he was the anointed Messiah. Now when Jesus was 8, was he the Messiah? No. When he was 12? No. When he expounded the doctors and the lawyers in the temple, was he the Messiah? Absolutely not. If you listen to this, it'll help you understand predestination greater. Can't you see how you could come to this earth and when you took the breath of life, that Brother Ben said that little seed was in you then. Amen. Yet it was not the anointed word. Amen. Glory. Amen. So watch him. But when the Holy Ghost came into him, he was the anointed Messiah. The Bible said God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself to the world, where the God living in him, the fullness of the Godhead was in him. God poured all he was into Christ. And Christ poured all he was into Brother Branham. That's the way most of the message folks believe it though. Why? Because they want to make the anointed Messiah again one person. Because it will never produce a rapturing faith in you to constantly point to Brother Branham or to point to Brother Donnie or point to some other man. You must find your place in the Word, and you cannot do it just from an intellectual standpoint. Notice again it says, spoken words original. See, Christ means the anointed one, a man that was anointed, and God dwelling in him. What was it? The germ with the flesh. The anointed one, the flesh, being anointed with the Spirit of God, produced the Word of God made manifest. So here when he come to the earth, what? He was the Word, but he was not the Word unfolded in his fullness until the Messiah, the anointing come. And when that come in him, it transformed him. Now he wasn't lost. He didn't need to be saved. He didn't need to be born again. But it took that word that he was and anointed that word. Hallelujah. Watch this again. He says, we find out. You say, why do you read so many quotes on this? Because you're doing good to believe it with all these quotes, much less if I just read one. We find at the age of 30, he was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist. And when he was baptized, going straightway out of the water, we find the Holy Spirit, God, in the form of a dove, coming from heaven in a voice saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm pleased to dwell. And the right translation of that, whom I'm pleased to dwell in, because God was in Christ. Now, let's read in Isaiah chapter 61. This is one, of course, you preacher brothers, and many of you that study the Bible, you know that this is one of the messianic prophecies of the Old Testament, one of the ones that the Jews really studied and looked forward to. Isaiah 61, 1. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Look at this word, Spirit, Ruach. The Spirit of the Lord God. So here he is, brooding again over the earth. Now he was the Word, but as the earth was, holding the seeds, and yet no life coming out until Ruach Elohim begin to brood upon the earth. Now here is the anointed Messiah. Now remember, this is prophetic. This could not be said when he was born. This could not be said in the temple. This could not be said when he was a teenager. This could only be said after he was baptized. So here Ruach comes down at the river and he begins to brood. What's he doing? Quickening the word to him. Now notice how Isaiah said this, the Spirit of the Lord God. Now look at the way this is spelled because it's very important. Capital L, lowercase o, lowercase r, lowercase d, which is Adonai. Lord spelt this way is Adonai. Now capital G-O-D is Elohim. So the Spirit of Adonai, Elohim, is upon me. Because the capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Jehovah. Now notice the compound names of God. Oh, glory. That is being unfolded when Messiah comes on the earth. Notice how God is revealing the person of his character. Once Messiah is anointed, can't you understand why it means so much to God to have a bride in the last day that is anointed? It's not that we can show off. It's not that we can show the people what we can do. It's that the character of our Father can be manifested, not us. So Ruach of Adonai Elohim is upon me because Jehovah has anointed me to play tapes. Oh, well, wait a minute. To preach. Well, glory. So I guess the anointed Messiah in this day will believe in preachers too. Now notice the Lord God is upon me because he, amen, the Lord, has anointed me to preach good things. Look at this word anointed. Mashach. Now this is actually where we get the word Messiah from. And it means to smear, anoint, a liquid to anoint as a consecration. So the Spirit of the Lord has smeared me. It has anointed me. It has set me aside. Friend, do you understand what the Meshach was? The Messiah. It's the exact same word that was used for the office of the high priest and also used for the kings of Israel, which were anointed by the prophets. So here they would take this man and they would take a cruse of oil. And God would tell them, pick out this boy, David. Pick out this man, this man, this man, and take that cruse of oil and pour it on his head. Now, when he received that oil, did he start shouting and jumping around and talking in tongues and jerking? No. The oil meant he was consecrated. He was set aside. Glory. And there was not another man on the earth that could take his place, for he was consecrated to be the high priest of the king. So you're Jesus. Amen. Jesus was the only one that could be Messiah, Ben David. So Isaiah said, the Spirit of Ruach, Adonai Elohim, has smeared me. He's anointed me and set me aside. I'm consecrated for a purpose. The Messiah is not feeling. It's not emotion. It's an action by God by which you are consecrated. This is why we must dress different, act different, look different, behave different. It is a sign of our consecration. No matter how chosen and predestined elect you think you are, if that does not set you apart away from the world, there's something wrong with your understanding of election. Amen. Now notice the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord hath anointed Mashach. The Lord hath messiahed me. to preach good things unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. Now, every Jew, after this was spoken, now the ones they begin to recognize, this has got to be Messiah. This is him. This is him. They looked for hundreds and hundreds of years. And yet when this is fulfilled and it walks around on the earth, they look right at it and say, saying we not well, thou art a Samaritan and hast a devil. Why? Because once the anointed word started acting out the prophetic utterance of the mind of God, they totally missed it. Because they took the logos, they took the written word, and they tried to put it together and figure how it would be. And when it happened, it went right over the top of their heads. Why? Because they were not anointed to see it. Notice in Psalms 45, 6, speaking of Jesus, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hatest wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God, hath anointed thee. Wait a minute, I thought this was talking to God himself. Look back here. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Thou lovest righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, thy God. So God is anointing God. Glory! God, hallelujah, the fatherhood is anointing the sonship. But because it came sonship, it did not lose the qualities of being divine. Let me bring it on down a little farther. God also is anointing a people as he had done since the birth of the church at Pentecost. Therefore, God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. All thy garments smell of myrrh and aloes and cassia out of the ivory palaces. Glory! Whereby they have made thee glad. Here is now Messiah, Ben David. Ben means son, of course, in Hebrew. So he is Messiah, son of David. Now when he comes, and these prophecies must dovetail to the letter. He cannot break one iota of those scriptures, and how is he ever going to do it himself? He must become anointed. He must receive the mind that was in God, and when God spoke these prophecies, to know whether they apply spiritually or naturally. The bulls of Bashan, they gape upon me. That wasn't literal. Come on. The bulls of Bashan, that was not literal. How's he going to know which is literal and which is spiritual? Same way you will. Notice Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. And a branch shall go out of his roots. And the spirit, ruach, of the Lord shall rest upon him. Not like the dove now that floated over the earth and could not find rest for the sole of her foot, but ruach will rest upon him. Amen. Oh, don't you want the kind of life that the Holy Ghost can rest upon you? Not just anoint you and leave, and anoint you and leave, and anoint you and leave, but he can come and take up his abode in your heart. The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Isaiah 42, 1, behold my servant whom I uphold, mine elect in whom my soul delighteth. I have put my spirit upon him. He shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. So here he comes upon the earth and he lives a very simple, humble life. For about 30 years, he's almost in the background, in the shadows. We see him at his dedication. We see him at the bar mitzvah at the age of 12. And then he disappears again. Now from 12 to 30, this one great godly life that had been prophesied for all those years, where is it in the scripture? What's he doing? Where is it? And it pleased God to leave those years, Brother Amos, of obscurity. And then you wonder why. You go through spots. But God told me this and God told me that. And then sometimes, man, you wish God would just rebuke you just to hear from me. You'd be glad just to let him know, man, he still loves me. He whooped me like I don't know what last night. You know what? When Jesus was here upon the earth from the age of 12 years old to 30 years old, nothing is said about him. Silent years of his life. Amen. And he was not even the anointed Messiah. He was the Word. What's he doing? Waiting. Well, the priest could not become priest till he reached the age of 30. So here, this great life that had been prophesied all of these years. No miracles, no signs, no wonders, all that sort of thing. Boy, it shows God thinks different than we do, don't he? Watch this in John 3:32. When he has seen and heard that he testifies, and no man receiveth his testimony. He that received his testimony has set his seal that God is true. For him whom God has sent speaketh the words of God. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure. By measure unto him. Now this is speaking of Jesus. Now, I'm not sure exactly where this olive oil originated. A lot of the olives come from the Mediterranean. Of course, some come from California, different places. But there could have been a gigantic vat that held thousands and thousands of gallons. And out of that vat, when it come underneath a mechanized machine, no doubt, and it come through, and a little bit went down in this bottle. And they make bottles that's about this size at the Bible bookstore. Little bitty tiny things you can slip in your pocket. But yet if we would be able to look back and study this, then we would find the same characteristics in this bottle or that bottle that existed in the gigantic vat whenever it was made a year ago, 6 months ago, 2 years ago, whatever it was. Amen. And it was extra, 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 extra virgin. So then when God gave it to him, it was not even in a size that could be measured. There was not a vat big enough. There was not enough bottles in the world because he gave it to him without measure. But his plan was to fill little tiny bottles. Some like that, and some maybe that size, and some that size, and some like this, and this wide, and this skinny, and this deep. But yet if we'd be able to go down inside of each of those containers and be able to look back, we would trace it right back to the original vat that was given to him without measure. But I'll have a measure, you'll have a measure, every one of us will have a measure, but would we still not be the anointed one? Now watch, Luke chapter 4, verse 16. He came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for it to read. You see, even when Jesus was here, he went to church. It was his custom. And you're his bride and say, you don't need to go. You better check up, pal. When Jesus was here, he went to church. It was a custom of his to go to church. He went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him by the Catholic priest his Bible and said, read it from my book, son. Glory! And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. Now you imagine, what was it that moved on that man's heart to not open up the book of Joel? What was it that moved on that man's heart not to open up the book of Genesis or Leviticus or Jeremiah? Why Isaiah? The anointed one has arrived. Oh, glory to God. Now he must be identified in the Word. Now his very life will make that Word alive. Because now he becomes a living voice of God. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. Now, why not open up to chapter 1, verse 1? Chapter 3, verse 2. Chapter 5, verse 6. But he found the part that pertained to the day. Call me nuts, call me crazy, call me whatever you want to call me, but I want to find the part of what pertains to right now. And if it's joined the denomination, let's just be like all the rest of them and praise God, we'll go right to it. But somehow I just can't hardly believe that's the anointed part for this time. Since the angel of Revelation 18 said, come out of her, my people, not go back into her. Now watch, so he opened the book, he found the place. Now of course if Jesus had never read and didn't really know what the word said, he could tell you about outdoor life and Better Homes and Gardens and all kinds of things on YouTube and all kinds of things on Golf Digest. But it showed Jesus had done his homework. Now you imagine as he unrolls it, Brother Tom, and he comes down. And he says this, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. You imagine the men. Of course, the women couldn't sit in the congregation. They was on the outside behind a veil there. And here the men were sitting there with a shawl wrapped around their head. You know, sitting there as the Jews would rock as they would read the word. Little did they know it had never been read like this before. They may have read it from their bar mitzvah up, because when the boy would reach 12, 13 years old, he now entered into manhood, and now he has the right to read the Torah, the law, because he is now a son of the law, the Torah. So he now has a right to read the law in public. And they may have memorized that scripture, and some of them may have sat there, and as Jesus was reading it, they quoted it right along with him. But Jesus is fixing to say something they couldn't say. Oh, they could quote the prophet. The prophet said this, and the prophet said that, and the prophet said something else. But when Jesus come to the spot to where he would say, the prophet was talking about me. Oh, my. Bring deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. Verse 20. And he closed the book and gave it again to the minister and sat down. Boy, some of us got up and walked out. A preacher sitting down to preach. Oh, Lord. He sure wasn't anointed. He sat down. How in the world could a man preach sitting down? Well, ask your God. He done it. Friends, it shows we don't understand what the anointing is. We think we've got to run and scream to the top of our voice. I believe in all that too. But if that's the only sign, Jesus wasn't anointed then. So here he comes and he sits down. And the eyes of them all were in the synagogue. Were fastened on him like yours are on me. And he began to say unto them. Now they had no problem as long as Jesus standing up reading quotes. The prophet of God said, 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 the prophet of God said. Had no problem. No revolt in the church. No split in the church. Nobody pouting on him. Until he began to apply the fulfillment of that word to its present tense. Oh my. Imagine all of them are sitting there and said, this guy's kind of strange anyway. What's he going to say? And he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Hallelujah. Now he walked in there, the anointed word. Now look what he does. He finds a place that is written of him. He already knew it. Now his life is going to anoint what they've read all of their lives. Now his life, it's not going to be a great pillar of fire, it's not going to be a rainbow coming down out of heaven, but it's going to be the anointed Christ, the Messiah, is going to identify that word, and they will be judged according to their attitude, not according to what the prophet said about it, but now according to the way they take what he said.
Oh.
Oh my. He began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Now the anointed Messiah standing in the pulpit. Notice what he does before he identifies himself in the scripture. He takes the quote book or the Bible or whatever you want to say, however you want to call it, and hands it back to the minister. Now the minister is sitting there holding the veiled word. The preacher of the synagogue is sitting there holding a book he does not understand. But there stands that word made flesh. The anointed word. Now here he's standing holding that word. Glory to God. Moses, the prophet of God, said, and the prophet of God said that, and the prophet of God said something else. But there stands the anointed word of that prophet of God made flesh. And the preacher sitting back there holding that word, making an idol out of it. And them people, Brother Skip, got so mad. They raised up in the synagogue. And the Bible says that they led Jesus down a place headlong. And they was going to throw him over a bluff and kill him. Sounds like message, folks, all right? And what did Jesus do? He didn't blind them. He just passed right amongst them. Just passed right amongst them and went on his way. Now notice, here the Messiah in the pulpit, identifying the written word, had now been made flesh. No jerking, no shouting, no jumping. Jesus didn't dance all over the platform and say, oh, I feel the anointing all over me. Glory to God. That's not what the anointing means. The anointing means set aside, set apart. Will you jump? Will you shout? Will you rejoice? Sure you will. But that don't mean that you're the Messiah. Notice back to Isaiah, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord hath anointed me to preach, to bear news, bear tidings, publish, preach, show forth, announce salvation as good news. Now this is where the word gospel comes from. The gospel. So Jesus, the anointed word, it's not just going to preach the word. He's going to preach the gospel. And the gospel is not word only. It's power, demonstration of the Holy Ghost. Now watch. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, opening a prison to them. Oh my, look. Who he's coming to now. To the meek. And the word meek means afflicted, distressed, needy. That's the only kind Jesus can help. You see, if you're sitting here tonight and think, man, that is some of the most shallow preaching I ever heard in my life, well, it'll do you absolutely no good. There could be volumes right here tonight that you've never even thought of or heard of, but as long as you don't think it that way, it won't do you one bit of good. Because you don't think you need it, you don't think you can get help, so what's he do? He comes to the meek. He comes to the distressed. He comes to those who say, you know what? I've been in this thing for 50 years, but I guarantee you one thing, there's more and more and more I can learn. That's the only ones he can help. Everybody else, he just cut yourself off. Now watch, he's to bind up the brokenhearted, those who are deeply afflicted and distressed. Oh my. To proclaim the liberty. Now this is the promise of the Messiah. The anointed Messiah is to bring deliverance, not church membership. Verse 2, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. Watch this day is the scripture fulfilled. notice a Messiah standing in the platform to identify himself with the word of promise for that age. Why didn't Jesus stand up and read Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14? A virgin shall conceive. Why didn't Jesus stand up and say, I'll give you a sign. Now look at the sundial of Ahaz. I'll give you a sign. A virgin shall conceive. Well, he was that. But that's pre-Messiah prophecy. So what's he do? He identifies, my friend. We can say, oh boy, my brother Branham was such a man of God. Man, he went on him and just, oh, glory to God. That's all good. That's all wonderful. What's that put you now? Where does that put you now? You want to just rejoice around a God who healed 50 years ago? I don't know about you. I need healing myself. I need deliverance in my life now. I need the power of God right now, not 50 years ago. So the Messiah is to preach the acceptable year. Notice Brother Ben says the acceptable year, as we all know as Bible readers, was the year of Jubilee. When all slaves and prisoners that had been taken prison, they had to give a son to pay a debt. Glory. Or a daughter to pay a debt. And they were in bondage. No matter how long they had been in bondage or how long they was supposed to be there. When the year come of the Jubilee and the trumpet sounded, every man could go free if he wanted to go free. Well, now, wait a minute. Why didn't the word do that? Why not just pass out tracts of Isaiah 61? Why not just make an audio recording of Isaiah prophesying that and hand it out among all the children of Israel? And just let them hear the prophet's voice. You see, it was not the anointed Messiah, my friends, when it was laying right here. Malachi 4 was not the anointed Messiah as long as it laid right here. It was not even the anointed Messiah of April 1906 or 1909, rather, when he was born. It was not even the anointed Messiah in the earlier years of his ministry. Ooh, glory. He said himself it was not when the seventh angel first started out, but when he began to sound his message. Was he a prophet of God? Certainly he was. Was he identified as a servant of God? Certainly he was. But he was not that anointed Messiah, the one anointed to what? Proclaim liberty from the denominations that had us bound. That's how you could set out yonder in the slop and the things of the world and then come to the churches and eat the slop that they fed you. And yet inside of you the whole time was a germ of life. And you thought, how in the world could I have done it? Because you had not walked into your anointing yet. Glory! But once you walked into that anointing, my brother, the year of Jubilee sounded for you. Oh, glory! Notice paragraph 48, what a perfect example it is of the gospel of Jesus Christ when it is preached the acceptable time, the time of Jubilee. Anybody, no matter who you are, what color you are, what denomination you belong to, how far you've stooped in sin. Boy, we all ought to be shouting on that. Amen. What's wrong with you? You can go free when you hear the gospel trumpet sound out. You are free. Now let me close with this. Can people be helped by listening to Brother Rem's tapes today? Certainly. Can people be healed? Absolutely they can. I've been healed. No doubt many of you have been healed too. As a prayer line or somebody come through with a discernment very similar to the situation you were in and God moved for you. But is that the anointed Messiah of this hour? The anointed Messiah is not a tape. It's not CDs from our church. Come on, children. The anointed Messiah must be people. People who look into the Word and find their place in the Word and they take
take the gospel that applies to this age, this time, 2012, right now in February of 2012. I can tell them of what he said in 65. I can point back and I'll continue to do so. But when it's all said and done and they need prayer and they're sick and they're all in the shape that they're in, or they want me to bring a tape player and lay that tape player on their head, or do they want me to stand there in the stead of Jesus Christ and lay my feeble hands on them and pray for them?
Let me find a place to close. Oh my. What's this? Verse 3, Isaiah 61, 3, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes.
Hallelujah.
The oil of joy for mourning. Jesus wanted to trade with you. He set up a barter store, as we'd say. He said, I want to make a trade with you, Jerry. Bring me your ashes. Bring me your sorrow, your burdens, your difficulty, your sins. And I'll trade something with you. Bring me your shattered life. Bring me your ruined situations. And I'll trade with you. Give you beauty for your ashes. I'll give you the oil of joy. Sounds like somebody else is fixing to get anointed. I'll give you the oil of joy for your mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. Why? That he might be glorified. Look at this. Oh my, let me just share this with you, because I will give you my beauty for ashes. Look at this word, beauty. It's Pierre, which means a headdress, a turban, tiara, or a diadem. The Redeemer, oh glory. The Redeemer would impart to his mourning people a tiara, the crown of a princess. Why do you think Disney has made millions and millions of dollars out of Sleeping Beauty and all the princess stories? Why do you think Cinderella and all the rest of these things, and it touches nearly every little girl and she wants to dress up like it and be like it? Why is it that we long in our folklore? Why is it that people long for a knight in shining armor? Why is it they long in a damsel in distress? She's held in captivity by a stepmother or whatever more, and yet, oh, you know the end of the story. You know she's going to come out. Why is it that they make such a big deal out of that? Because, friend, there is a real princess. Glory. And she was held in a prison by that old dragon, the devil. But Jesus said, I'll come down, little bride. I will give you the oil of joy for the spirit of heaviness. Oh, glory. Now look what he's saying. The custom of the Orientals were, when they were in distress, whether someone died, or they lost a lot of cattle, a lot of possessions, or just in deep despair, they'd put on sackcloth, they'd go up to their fireplace or outside, and they'd take dirt, ashes, put it all over their head, all over their face, and then they would start mourning and crying. All that ashes blending in with their tears. You're talking about a mess. But Jesus said, come on, sweetheart. Get them ashes out of your face. Get them ashes out of your hair. And put on this queen's crown. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh,
glory. Notice what they would do when they were in mourning. They would never anoint themselves with oil. When they was in sorrow, they would never anoint themselves with oil. But he said, let me have your sorrow and you won't have to anoint yourself. I will. I'll Meshach you. I will Messiah you. I will anoint you. I'll take your spirit of heaviness. I'll take it from you if you'll let me. I'll take it from you and I will anoint you and make you the anointed Messiah. Oh, God. Thank you, Jesus. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Now, the Orientals' custom was to express their feelings by the attire that they wore. And they would never wear a loud, bold-colored garment to express deepness of sorrow. But he says, take him grave clothes off and put on a real garment of praise. Get your dancing shoes on because we're fixing to get married. Glory! Get rid of that old heavy garment that weighted you down and take on a garment of praise. And there's one thing about the Jews. They always had dancing at weddings. Well, glory, don't get scared now. They always had dancing at weddings. So that wouldn't be fitting for you to walk in with widow's garments on and a big black veil over your face and black gloves and a black dress on. He said, bride, get rid of that. Put on that garment of praise. Come in here where you can dance around and whirl around in the presence of God. Get that old black veil off your face. Get rid of them black gloves. Oh. I'm going to turn you from mourners to living trees. Notice Brother Brown said when he come down upon him, he become the anointed Messiah. Let me jump and we'll read one more. Brother Ronnie, come down if you would. Skip that next quote there. Brother Brown says, what's this? Speaking about the anointed one today. The anointed one today is the messianic. Say it if you're not afraid. I want you to look at this year, 1960. And Brother Branham is on the earth. Now why didn't Brother Branham say the anointed Messiah is me? The rest of you preachers better sit down. Notice where he puts it in 60. How much farther ought we to be up the road? 50 some years later. Why does it still stagger us when we hear these things? The anointed one today is the Messiah church. This church of the newborn. Jump down there, he says, the messianic church. Glory, why? Messiah church will have the signs of the Messiah because it's the messianic church. It is the church of the Messiah. Amen. Don't you love that theological term? Oh, glory! Brother Bram said, that makes me feel as good as that fellow did a while ago. Now, this is up in Middletown, Ohio, and there'd been a guy come through there that cut a shine before Brother Bram comes up through there. He said, this makes me feel as good as it did that fellow a while ago. What ought it to do to us? Oh, glory. Listen. Should we hand out tapes? By all means.
Should we print books and all this? By all means. Amen. Buy Bibles, by all means. But remember, the Messiah is not this. This is not the Messiah. The Messiah is the church. And the first Messiah got sick. So can you. The first Messiah sat outside the city and groaned with a headache. So can you. Because you're the anointed one, don't mean that you're changed from being a human. It means you're set apart, called out, set aside. And you got on a garment of praise. You're anointed for a purpose. Our thinking must be different. Our behavior must be different. We don't even belong to ourselves. We belong to the one who set us apart for this service. The anointed word. Now I want you to look at yourself for just a moment before we pray. It's so much easier, friends, for us to just listen to tapes or listen to preachers preach and acknowledge that what they're, that's right. Yeah, amen, amen, that's right. Yes, sir, but I believe every word of that. That still don't mean that you're anointed with it.
That's right. That's correct.
We put so much confidence in our memory and our intellect, being able to quote, quote, quote. But Jesus looked into the word and it gave him faith. That's a quote. Perfect faith, 1963. So Jesus looked into the word and it gave him faith. But it could only do that after he became anointed. Then he read it through anointed eyes. And once we become more anointed, now, the mystery of the change, the translation, the rapture, will it really be that hard? Will it really be that difficult? Will it not just simply be another step in our journey? People are looking for a new tape, and the old my brother Justin, they'll find a tape, and on there on the tape says rapture and faith. Brother Man never even said that. Closest one you look at, 1962, and they butchered all the pieces by saying that. You're lying when you say that, because Brother Man never said that. If rapture and faith itself laid on the tapes, all you'd have to do is listen to the tapes, and you'd get rapture and faith, which means the devil could do it too. He could live like the devil, except 5 minutes before the rapture, listen to tapes, get rapture and faith, and go to heaven. Lord have mercy, if he's going to heaven, I want to go to hell. Why in the world would I want to go to heaven if he's going to be there? But one day, what we've heard, and sometimes you come and say, well, I didn't get that much out of church, did you? I sat there and I was reverent and I was nice and all that. I didn't get that much out of church. Probably one of them services you thought you didn't get nothing. One day the Holy Ghost, Christos, will come over you and anoint you and say, remember that service you didn't get? Bam! Wow! Man, I'm glad I went to church that night. I didn't think I got nothing. That's your old knothead thinking that. Amen. That's our old intellect thinking. But you know what? The soul feeds when the body don't even know what's going on. The soul feeds and gets things out of the word that the intellect has no idea what's been absorbed. And Christos moves over there and say, whoo, my Lord. Oh, all for the hour when the bride can turn over into the word.
Amen.
Turn over into the word.
Yes, sir.
As for years and years and years, we've looked for more scriptures and more scriptures and more scriptures to identify Brother Branham. A lot of folks, friends, it's pitiful. I keep a lot of it hid from me because I don't want you to deal with a lot of the trash. But if you only knew, people spend their lives searching this Bible to try to find another scripture to prove Brother Branham. They spend their life trying to find something to make Brother Branham greater and Brother Branham bigger and Brother Branham more colossal and Brother Branham this and Brother Branham that, and they'll never see who they are. They'll never find who they are. It's wonderful we've seen Brother Branham. Let's not make him any more than God made him and give him the greatest ministry a man could ever have. We thank God for that. We rejoice in that, Brother Terry, but I want to find my place. I want to find Donnie in the Word. And I don't want to just find him where I can say, oh, mama, that's me. But I want it to be quickened from within me. Oh, glory. Friends, you understand what happened to that little eagle? I'm trying to close. You understand what happened to that little eagle? When his mama flies over that barnyard and she finally found him. And Brother Bam said, oh, for that resurrection to recognize he was not a chicken. He had a resurrection. Oh, glory. Do you understand what happened? He said, mama, what can I do? She said, jump. You're an eagle. He said, but he'd been taught all of his life he couldn't do that. He said he was a chicken. Now think what Brother Bam said. He said that eagle was a chicken. Where? In his thinking. He didn't have one chicken feather in him. He didn't have one chicken intellect in him, but he was a chicken in his thinking. A lot of us are Branhamites in our thinking. Why is it, friend, we get scared to death and we hear things like that? Why is it you folks get scared to death? And if there's a church on the face of the earth that's heard this preach, it's been this church. Why is it you still get scared? What are you afraid of? Let me tell you who it is. It's your enemy. He don't mind you making God out of Brother Branham. But he don't even want you to see you're a son or daughter of God. He wants you to look at yourself as some slimy piece of trash. I think it's time we recognize I'm the very reason God sent Brother Branham. You're the very reason God sent Brother Branham to this earth. Brother Branham didn't come to this earth for his health. He didn't come for popularity. He came to be the anointed one, to speak a message that would bring the bride up, that she can recognize who she is. Glory. Do you see what happened to that little eagle? When he looked up there at his mama, it quickened his mortal body. Now, I told you a week or so ago, used to, when I was back in Pentecost, I used that scripture for shouting. But I found out when I come to the message, Brother Bam and Dan went away, plotted it all. Notice what happens to that eagle. It quickens his mortal body. And it brings his mortal body into subjection to that image. And it's thinking, I'm a chicken, cluck, cluck, cluck. I'm a chicken, cluck, 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 cock-a-doodle-doo. But all of a sudden, his thinking became quickened. By seed, he was an eagle. By nature, he was an eagle. But he hadn't been anointed yet. But his mama flew over and he became the anointed one. Where from? His mama's mouth. Oh, glory to God. Then his mama helped him see, Brother Jim, you're not a chicken. You're not a chicken. That's why you've always been different. You're not a chicken. Oh, you imagine. Brother Bam said she told him, flop those wings. Get a little exercise in them. Whew. You imagine him standing there and all the dust started boiling around. And the pastor is, get out of here. Don't do that. Call. Get out of here. You're a call. And he was just, ooh. You can't get them wings stronger by looking at that rooster pastor. Brother Man said, if your pastor don't preach what the word said, he's a feeder of the hens, not a feeder of the eagles. Directly, it come to him. He saw himself in her. Now he's the anointed Messiah. You're gone for deep end. You're gone for fanaticism. If you leave, we'll never let you come back. We're the ones who prayed for you to play the guitar. We give you a place to preach. We're the one who lets you sing. Can you imagine? It rose in him. And all of a sudden, his body became quickened. It quickened his mortal body. And he started going, Lord, I feel like I could fly right now. Oh, glory to God. What happened, friends? It quickened his body. It changed him. Don't you see that's what the Word is doing? Wanting to quicken our body, bring it subject to the Word. And what will the change be? Only another step of that. Praise the Lord. To appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that He might be glorified. God didn't give me a ministry so I'd be a big name preacher. God didn't give me the rest of these preachers a ministry so there'd be some great renown, something. God gives us anything from Himself that it might bring Him glory. Amen. And honor. So if you're here tonight and you've got them ashes all over your face and your hair, you're hardly recognizable, come with me. I know where there's a store run by my daddy. Oh, but I've got ashes in my face and I've been crying and they're running all down my face and the tears. And that's okay. He don't care what you look like. But I can't see. I've got these tears in my eyes. That's why He sent me to help lead you. You say, how could you say that? How could I not? We are here, friends, as an extension of His hands. Come with me. Come with me. Let's walk down this aisle. Let Him put a tiara on your head. Let Him take that old spirit of heaviness off of you. Let Him take all those things. And you'll be called the planting of the Lord. Let's bow our heads together if you would. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, I pray. Help us tonight, Lord. When Brother Branham finishes his sermon is the rising of the sun. It comes down just a few paragraphs from the end. And he said, maybe you've sat in this tabernacle, you've listened to tapes, and yet the Spirit has never come upon you, the quickening power. So it shows us that Brother Branham himself believed a person could listen to tapes and never be quickened. They could come here to Happy Valley, listen to me and these other brothers, and still not be quickened. Lord Jesus, I pray. May your great anointing, may it not just make us cry and shout, but may we become the anointed one.
Yes.
The ones that's consecrated and set aside to do your work.
Yes.
We'll feel you, we'll cry, we'll run, we'll jump, we'll dance when you send that. But the good thing about being the Messiah is we're anointed whether we feel it or not. I remember how I was in Pentecostal Lord, my first years coming to the message. When I didn't feel it, I was in a mess. Because I just couldn't understand it. But I realized the anointed one is anointed when we're sick. Anointed when we're weary. King David, after he was anointed by the prophet Samuel, had some of the greatest battles of his life. Oh, glory. He might not have felt you nowhere around, but he was still the anointed king. Saul hated him, sought to kill him, but he was the anointed one. Help them tonight, Lord, to see they're the anointed one in battles, in tests, in trials, in storms. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, if there's one here that don't know you, in the way of peace, being a tree of the Lord,
May they be able to come up to your counter tonight. May they hand you their dust and ashes, their heavy spirit. May they trade free of charge. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray for your children that are saved tonight and filled with the Holy Ghost. Maybe they're discouraged. Maybe they're sick. Maybe they need something in their life. May you come by tonight this way, Lord Jesus. Help us to see we've been called and set aside for this time and for this season. We are the actors on the scene. The closing acts of the Gentile history are laying before us. Jeremiah isn't here. Elijah isn't here. Ezekiel. We would think, my, you would have saved the greatest actors for the closing scene. But yet, you let them live their life and they've gone. Church age messengers are gone. The great prophets are gone. And who have you left on the earth? Poor little people like us. And we're to say the last words. We're to make the last comments. And to end this whole drama with a crescendo of divine glory. Oh, Lord Jesus. How can we ever do it? We cannot just by the word. We cannot just by memorizing and studying. But if we can become the anointed Messiah, then we too one day can stand and say, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up. And we'll be able to stand there and say, this day, this scripture is fulfilled. Oh, grant it, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Can we just raise our hands in his presence? Friends, don't just be a Christian. Don't be a Reaganite. Don't be a Branhamite. I don't mean that disrespectful to Brother Branham. Don't be a Pruittite or a Biscolite. God wants you to be the anointed church, the Messiah. One set aside. Anointed to finish his work. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Arise to your place, Esther. Take your part in the Father's drama. One night with the King changes every scene. One day in his courts it forever changed my course. One moment in his presence, oh, I've never been the same. One night with the King changes. Many of you know that the doctors have found cancer in Brother Eugene's thyroid, and they're looking at removing a large portion or all of it. But yet, we believe tonight that there's a great physician here. And we know that the way he chooses to do things is not always our way. Paul prayed for deliverance of a thorn, but God gave him grace to bear it. He prayed for a natural fulfillment and got a spiritual understanding. So we want to pray for our brother tonight. For a long time he's been sick and we haven't found out what his trouble was. And that devil hid. But thank God they've been able to find what it is. There's other requests that he's got on his heart for him and his family. Do y'all believe what you've heard tonight? That the Lord Jesus himself is right here among us tonight. Anointing a church. Brother Roberts, come help me. Brother Horn, you missed your brothers, if you would. Lord Jesus, as your children and as ministers of the gospel, our hands are poor substitutes for yours. If somehow, Lord, Brother Eugene would have lived in the day when you were here and his wife could have been able to brought him to one of your meetings in Samaria, or maybe he'd have sat there that day at Nazareth and heard you read those words and with this disease in his body, and maybe on your way out if he could have touched you. No doubt, Lord God, you could have healed him. But yet, Father, tonight you are still here anointing a people, a body. And Brother Branham said the same signs will be in that anointed body. So you healed cancer and diseases when you were here. You healed it when Brother Branham was here. And Brother Branham is in Hebrews 13:8, but you are. We are in Hebrews 13:8, but you are. Lord Jesus, we pray for our brother tonight, Father. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that they've been able to find what's going on with him, Lord. They've done so many tests, and Lord, they've put him through so many things. Lord Jesus, we just give you praise tonight, Lord. I know right now in your presence, dear God, Lord Jesus, what's cancer to the power of the Holy Ghost. Father, I'm asking you right now in the name of Jesus, you'd move for our brother. Lord God, cancer is nothing but a multiplication of cells and a demon life that comes in there. Oh, but God, hallelujah. It is a perversion of the original. Tonight, Father, I join my faith with these brothers and the saints of God. In the name of Jesus, Lord God, may my brother be healed. We curse this thing from him. May the very life of this growth leave him, Lord God. In the name of Jesus Christ, Satan, I adjure you by the power of the living God. Come out. Go for my brother's body. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord Jesus, you who walked on the water, you who spoke your word, speak it again tonight, Lord God. Make our brother well. Meet these needs, Lord Jesus, I pray. Grant it, Lord God. Grant it, Lord God. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. How many believes him? Now I'm going to ask you for a favor. I've been sick about all week. I got a tooth pulled on Monday, and I've been sick ever since. I come to church Wednesday night and so sick, I about fell in the office. Our Brother Louis had to catch me where I almost passed out. Again tonight, I had Brother Robert and Brother Jim to pray for me before I came out. God would help me. Amen. He did.
Glory!
He did. But I don't just want help. I want to be better. Amen. So will you reach your hands this way toward me? Some of you brothers want to lay your hands on me.
Amen.
Oh, God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, glory.
Lord
we
Jesus.
Come to you now
yes,
in the name Lord of the Lord Jesus.
Heavenly
hallelujah.
Father, help me, Lord, tonight. Dear God,
we believe.
We believe you, Lord Jesus. We look to the promises of your word tonight, Lord. I thank you for helping me tonight, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus. I pray you just move this thing out of my body, Lord. Whatever it is, dear God, I ask you in Jesus' name. Help me, Heavenly Father. Touch me tonight, Lord God. May every symptom of it leave me, I pray, Lord God. I believe you, Lord Jesus. Grant it, dear God. Help me tonight, Lord, I pray. Glory! Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord Jesus. We believe you, Lord.
Hallelujah!
Thank you, Lord Jesus. We look to you.
Glory!
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah!
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
We believe, Father.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Destroy.